hospital in one of the country's poorest regions.
Part of this morning's Washington Journal will take you back live now to the hearing about to get underway. Chairman Henry Waxman of Energy and Commerce, live coverage, C-SPAN 3.
The committee will please come to order. Today, the committee continues consideration of H.R. 3200, America's Affordable Health Choices of 2009. When the committee recessed last week, the chairman's amendment in the nature of a substitute was pending. The substitute is open to amendment at any point. However, to promote orderly and thoughtful deliberation of the amendments, I will continue to exercise the chair's power of recognition to give priority to amendments in order of division. As I announced yesterday, today we will start the markup with amendments to Division B. I know as we turn to these divisions of the bill that we will face many attractive amendments which potentially carry some cost implications. Some of these will be moderate of impact, and we will certainly try to accommodate them. But if the impact of the amendment is to add to the cost of the bill, and they are not paid for, members should understand that when the bills are meshed on the House floor, it may be extremely difficult to retain them. I will, of course, work to accommodate the committee's priorities. I will also exercise the chair's power of recognition to prioritize recognition of members offering amendments that have been submitted consistent with the two-hour advance submission policy. I discussed in a memo to members and in previous markup sessions this procedure. I also want to note that it is appropriate for a member to offer as one amendment several amendments grouped together, provided each amendment has been submitted consistent with the advance submission policy. I will now turn to the amendment pending in nature of a substitute.
Parliamentary inquiry.
Yes, Mr. Barton's recognized.
I listened with keen interest to your opening statement. At the beginning of this markup last week, you indicated, as you had to, according to the rules of the House and the committee, that the amendment, the nature of the substitute, once you've adopted it, is open to amendment at any point. But you also indicated that you prefer to go by title, which we agreed to, with the understanding that at some point in the markup, it would be open, the amendment, the nature of substitute, would be open for amendment at any point. Well, Mr. Chairman, in my opinion, that time is now. I just heard you tell one of the members on your side that there was some indication you might try to finish by midnight today. You've told me you hope to finish by 2 tomorrow. We're going to have a number of votes on the floor, probably several times. We have spent a day and a half on Division C or Title C, and as of 7 o'clock last night, we were told we wanted to finish Title C, but at 9 o'clock this morning, we're now told we're going to do Title B. Most of the real meat and potatoes in this bill is in Title A. So based on what you just said about the power of recognition and the people could group amendments and people might have amendments adopted that would be stricken when the bill goes to the floor, if it goes to the floor because of the cost, it sounds to me like you're going to try to do a hopscotch markup where you pick two or three amendments from your side, adopt them, and then shut the process down without us having a full and open markup. I strongly object to that. I'd like your word kept, which was what you said at the beginning last week, that at some point in time this bill would be open to amendment at any point. The minority would agree to time limits on amendments. We'll agree to with some discussion, total number of amendments offered, but we can't be put in a position where we're going to, while one part of your caucus is upset, we're going to be on one part of the bill, and when you get them happy, we're going to go to another part of the bill, and then in that one golden moment when you've got everything in balance, we move the bill. And that's what it sounds to me like you're trying to do.
If the gentleman would yield to me.
I'd be happy to yield.
I want to assure you that we are not going to close out the opportunity for any member to offer amendments on any part of this bill. We are proceeding by division in order to have an orderly process. I had to smile when you overheard the conversation I had with Mr. Butterfield about trying to, as you interpreted, finish the bill by tonight. Oh, that it only could be so. But I was talking to him about how late we may go tonight, and I told him not to make any appointments before 1 a.m. to Friday morning. I expect we'll be back here tomorrow. We're not going to close out anybody's opportunity to offer amendments. Let me assure you that we will proceed in an orderly way, and I'll be glad to talk to you further informally about how the committee can process the legislation in a fair way.
Well, does that mean if at 2 o'clock tomorrow there's still 20 amendments that are substantive that haven't been offered, that you're going to roll the markup over till the fall?
I hope we don't come to that situation. We want to assure you that we're going to take all the priority amendments and try to be fair for every member. And in fact, I want to get every amendment offered. We may be able to do that with some time limits on the discussion of the amendment, but I'm not going to preclude you or anyone else from a chance to offer amendments.
Well, I'm going to take you at your word on that, Mr. Chairman. We hopefully will have sufficient time today and tomorrow to get every amendment that members want offered.
Let me suggest that we talk informally about time limits on amendments for starting today, so that we can just move forward and complete our business.
I would right now say that on any specific amendment, the minority is prepared to limit debate on our side to no more than 10 minutes per amendment, starting right now.
Well, I appreciate that offer. Let me check that out with our side and see if it's consistent with full deliberation. But it sounds like you've given us a very attractive offer.
There you go. Well, we will keep our word.
Thank you, Mr. Barton.
Thank you.
When the committee recessed last week, the chairman's amendment in the nature of a substitute was pending. And I want to now recognize Mr. Gett for for her amendment.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I have an amendment at the desk. It's DeGette 6-7.
And may I ask the clerk, before that amendment is reported, is this in Title B? And has it been available for more than 2 hours?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Without objection, the amendment will be considered as read, and the gentlelady from Colorado is recognized.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, this amendment is a combined amendment of two amendments that I had filed last night. And the first part of it is the recognition of certified diabetes educators as certified providers for purposes of Medicare diabetes outpatient self-management training services. The second part of the amendment includes podiatrists as Medicaid providers. Mr. Chairman, these are two. I'm the co-chair of the Congressional Diabetes Caucus, the largest issue-related caucus in the Congress. And these are two of the top priorities of the Diabetes Caucus this year. As we all know, that diabetes is one of the top public health threats today. It's the leading cause of blindness in adults, the leading cause of kidney failure, the cause of 60% of non-traumatic lower limb amputations, and so on. If we include certified diabetes educators as Medicare providers, this will help give people the tools they need to control their diabetes and go directly to the providers to get that education and knowledge. I want to thank Zach Space.
Will the gentlelady yield?
I'd be happy to yield.
We'll accept the amendments.
Great. Let me just thank Zach Space. Let me thank Greg Walden and Mr. Shimkus and Ms. Bono Mack, Mr. Upton and Whitfield on the podiatrist amendment, and everybody else on the committee who has helped, and I will yield back.
Will the gentlelady
I'll yield
to
the
me.
Chairman first.
Thank you very much. I want to thank you for your hard work on these two amendments and for your tireless efforts as an advocate for Americans suffering from diabetes and other chronic diseases. These two provisions will be of tremendous help to diabetics and Medicaid. The first provision includes certified diabetes educators among those providers that can deliver diabetes self-management training. The second provision would add services furnished by podiatrists to the definition of medical assistance. Catching diabetic neuropathy early is often the key to preventing diabetics from enduring debilitating amputations. Together, these amendments ensure that diabetics and Medicaid have access to the critical care they need. I'm pleased that this amendment has such broad support, and I certainly want to urge our colleagues to support it.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have an even longer and more brilliant statement that I was going to make, but to move this process along, I will yield back my time and thank the chairman and also the ranking member for.
Without objection, the full statement of the members on this amendment will be added to the record. Any further discussion of these amendments? If not, we'll proceed to a vote. All those in favor of the DeGette amendment will say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. The ayes have it and the amendments agreed to. Let me turn to the Republican side. Mr. Burgess, you have an amendment?
I have an amendment at the desk, Burgess 18.
I'd like to ask the clerk before she reports the amendment if the amendment is to Title B and has it been available for the requisite 2 hours.
It has, Mr. Chairman.
Without objection, the amendment will be considered as read, and I recognize the gentleman for Texas to explain his amendment.
I thank the gentleman for recognition. Now, in the base bill in front of us, 3200, it recognizes the formula under which we pay reimbursed physicians under the Medicare system, under the sustainable growth rate. It cuts Medicare payments on a nearly annual basis, and it has to be fixed. But as far as the base bill goes, it still puts physicians in this country in a position where they could face yearly cuts with a formula that is still fundamentally, inexorably linked to the gross domestic product. And as we all know, the gross domestic product has been declining this year. Therefore, physicians could anticipate a reduction in reimbursement based in a formula based on gross domestic product. The amendment that I'm offering builds off of the base bill to give physicians and patients what they really need, a stable and reasonable predictor of an inflation of reimbursements that are subject to inflationary pressures. This amendment is going to do a great deal of good for patients and for the doctors who provide for them. It will keep current law for 2009. That's the bad news, but the good news is it will rebase the sustainable growth rate formula in 2010, providing a modest increase, and in 2011, switch to an update that is linked to the Medicare Economic Index, a cost of living index, if you will. Now, as you know, Mr. Chairman, the doctors are scheduled to receive a 20% reduction in payments if we do nothing by the end of this year. Trustees for Medicare have projected Medicare payments to doctors will be cut by several percentage points if Congress does not act. Consider this. Doctors who are seeing our most vulnerable patients, our senior citizens, will face a cumulative cut of 25% to 35% over the next 5 years if we do nothing. But imagine what that's going to mean for those who depend upon the Medicare system for their medical care. These increases are coming as a result of flaws in the Medicare formula created by the Congress, and there's almost universal agreement that increases rather than decreases are necessary, and that this formula is a mistake by Congress, which we've not yet been able to successfully fix. We all hear about new Medicare beneficiaries finding it difficult to find a doctor that will take Medicare. When seniors relocate, it can be a struggle for them to find a doctor who is willing to take them on. This is all because doctors around the country realize that Medicare is an unstable payer, subject to the whims of political will and influence, and are doing what they have to do in order to protect themselves and their businesses. Can you imagine going into your banker with a business plan that says, I'm going to expand my business? The banker says, well, what can you show me about the stability of your income stream for the years to come? What's this about a 20% cut at the end of this year? It's an untenable position that we put our doctors in this country. We need a permanent fix to the formula, and if now is not the time, when are we contemplating a bill that, if not now, when is a better time? We're contemplating a bill that costs almost $1 trillion over 10 years, perhaps even more than that. This is the correct time to provide that fix. When can we tell our country that their doctors will not have to live under this sword of Damocles every year that may result in cuts in their reimbursement? This amendment is about priorities. A vote for this amendment is a vote for the nation's seniors. A vote against this amendment is a vote for the status quo. And we all know our president has said the status quo is not acceptable. So with that, Mr. Chairman, I thank you for the recognition, and I'll yield back the balance of my time.
Gentleman yields back the balance of his time. Who seeks recognition on this amendment? Mr. Braley.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to remind my friend from Texas that that sword of Damocles was raised over the head of physicians in this country by a Republican-controlled Congress. This bill provides a comprehensive, permanent overhaul of the SGR that falls within the PAYGO adjustment allowance. And this House is committed to passing a statutory PAYGO, and one of the baseline adjustments in our legislation is for the sustainable growth rate, the update mechanism for physician payments in Medicare. That adjustment allows us to make a $245 billion change without applying the normal PAYGO rules. Repealing the SGR formula in favor of permanent updates would add about $60 billion in cost to this bill. And our bill, H.R. 3200, provides incentives now for the provision of primary care services and the formation of accountable care organizations. This amendment undoes all of that. Paying for health care reform, as we all know, is a heavy lift, and every dollar of spending added is another dollar we need from revenues or program reductions elsewhere. The SGR reform in the bill is the responsible path. It wipes the slate clean and reforms the system, but does it in a fiscally responsible way. And I would also note that the update for 2010, based upon the Medicare Economic Index, wipes away accumulated deficits to provide for a fresh start. It also excludes items not paid for under the Medicare fee schedule, like prescription drugs and lab services. It provides an extra growth allowance for primary care services and encourages accountable care organizations to take responsibility for quality and cost. And Mr. Chairman, we've worked hard to move the cost curve by promoting a change in the way Medicare is paid for, moving from a quantity-based toward a quality-based system. This amendment would go in the opposite direction, and that's why I oppose it and urge my colleagues to oppose it as well.
Further discussion of the amendment. Mr. Barton.
And I'll be very brief, Mr. Chairman. This is a put your money where your mouth is amendment. Both sides have said they want to fix the SGR system. This does it permanently. There are no gimmicks. It puts in place an MEI index that's adjusted for inflation each year. The PAYGO bill that passed the floor last week doesn't require, exempts this particular amendment from PAYGO, but we feel like that it would score the cost over 10 years of this amendment, we believe, would be in the $300 to $340 billion, or say $34 billion per year. We also believe if we had to come up with cost savings, even though it's been exempted under PAYGO, that we could do that. So this is a straightforward, if you really are telling your doctors that you want to fix permanently the SGR, then this is the amendment to vote for to tell them that you're really going to do it. And with that, I yield back.
Gentleman yields back the balance of his time. Ms. Capps.
I want to just add on to, I won't repeat what my colleague from Iowa has said, in opposition to the amendment and in favor of what the underlying bill does in the way of SGR reform, which is substantial and is paid for. This amendment is not fiscally responsible. We have included the structure that several groups, I will include for the record, but including the American Medical Association and some other groups as well. There's a huge list of them. I'm only going to pick out three or four. The American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists, which I think the amendment author knows something about, and the American College of Physicians and the American College of Surgeons. I will leave it at that and yield back to someone.
If you yield to me, I join you in opposition. This amendment would add $60 billion to the cost of the bill, and I have not seen a way to pay for it, and I join my colleagues who have urged that we defeat the amendment.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Burgess, I'm going to recognize you to close on your amendment, and then we'll proceed to a vote.
Very, very briefly, two things. First off, we talk about what this costs. The reality is this money is not sitting in an account somewhere drawing interest. This money has already been dispersed. If we were a private company and carried our books this way, we'd all go to jail. The other thing is on the groups that have endorsed this bill, I suspect if you ask any member, any physician member of the ACOG, American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists, or the American Medical Association, if they would favor a permanent repeal of the SGR and delinking it from the gross domestic product, I don't think there's any question of what they would tell you. And finally, do not forget that everything that is done within the Medicare system, the private sector bases their reimbursement formula on what we do in Medicare. So it is not just a Medicare issue. This affects Cigna, United, Blue Cross, all of the health care companies out there that also provide reimbursement for our physicians. They're going to base their formulas off of what Medicare does. So this is the implications are not just for Medicare. They are far-reaching throughout the medical profession in this country, and I'll yield back.
Are we ready for the vote? All those in favor of the Burgess Amendment say aye. Opposed? No. No.
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to ask a roll call vote.
Okay, let's proceed to a roll call vote.
Mr. Waxman?
No.
Mr. Waxman votes no. Mr. Dingell? Mr. Dingell votes no. Mr. Markey? Mr. Boucher? Mr. Pallone? Mr. Pallone votes no. Mr. Gordon? Mr. Rush? Ms. Eshoo? Ms. Eshoo, no. Mr. Stupak? Mr. Stupak, no. Mr. Engel? Mr. Green? Ms. DeGette? Ms. DeGette votes no. Mrs. Capps? Mrs. Capps, no. Mr. Doyle? Ms. Harmon? Ms. Harmon, no. Ms. Schakowsky? Ms. Schakowsky, no. Mr. Gonzalez? Mr. Gonzalez, no. Mr. Inslee? Ms. Baldwin? Ms. Baldwin votes no. Mr. Ross? Mr. Ross, no. Mr. Weiner? Mr. Weiner, no. Mr. Matheson? Mr. Butterfield? Mr. Butterfield, no. Mr. Melanson? Mr. Melanson, no. Mr. Barrow? Mr. Barrow, no. Mr. Hill? Mr. Hill, no. Ms. Matsui? Ms. Matsui, no. Mrs. Christensen? Mrs. Christensen, no. Ms. Castor? Ms. Castor, no. Mr. Sarbanes?
Hey, how are you?
Mr. Sarbanes, no. Mr. Murphy of Connecticut? Mr. Murphy, no. Mr. Space? Mr. Space, no. Mr. McNerney? Mr. McNerney, no. Ms. Sutton? Ms. Sutton, no. Mr. Braley? Mr. Braley, no. Mr. Welch? Mr. Welch, no. Mr. Barton? Mr. Barton votes aye. Mr. Hall? Mr. Hall, aye. Mr. Upton? Mr. Upton, aye. Mr. Stearns? Mr. Deal? Mr. Deal, aye. Mr. Whitfield? Mr. Whitfield, aye. Mr. Shimkus? Mr. Shimkus, aye. Mr. Shattuck? Aye. Mr. Shattuck, aye. Mr. Blunt?
Aye.
Mr. Blunt, aye. Mr. Boyer? Mr. Radonovich?
Aye.
Mr. Radonovich, aye. Mr. Pitts?
Aye.
Mr. Pitts, aye. Ms. Bono Mack? Ms. Bono Mack, aye. Mr. Walden?
Aye.
Mr. Walden, aye. Mr. Terry?
Aye.
Mr. Terry, aye. Mr. Rogers?
Aye.
Mr. Rogers, aye. Mrs. Myrick? Mr. Sullivan? Mr. Murphy of Pennsylvania? Mr. Murphy, aye. Mr. Burgess?
Aye.
Mr. Burgess, aye. Ms. Blackburn? Ms. Blackburn, aye. Mr. Gingrey?
Aye.
Mr. Gingrey, aye. Mr. Scalise? Mr. Scalise, aye. Mr. Markey. Mr. Markey votes no. Mr. Rush. Mr. Rush, no. Mr. Inslee. Mr. Inslee votes no. Mr. Green. Mr. Green, no. Mr. Stearns?
Aye.
Mr. Stearns votes aye. Mr. Matheson. Mr. Matheson votes no.
Have all members responded to the call of the roll? Any member wish to change his or her vote? If not, the clerk will tally the vote. Yes.
On that vote, Mr. Chairman, the yeas were 20, the noes were 32.
20 ayes, 32 noes. The amendment is not agreed to. Mr. McNerney, do you have an amendment?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I have an amendment at the desk.
Before the clerk reports it, will she inform us whether the amendment is to this title and has been available for 2 hours?
Yes, it has, Mr. Chairman.
The clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3200 offered by Mr. McNerney of California and Mr. Tim Murphy of Pennsylvania.
Without objection, the amendment will be considered as read and the gentleman is recognized for 5 minutes. Oh, before you begin, Mr. Barton was generous enough to suggest a time limit on all amendments, and I'd like to take him up on that offer and put it to a unanimous consent request that all amendments will be debated 10 minutes on each side, and then we'll proceed to a vote.
No longer than 10 minutes on each side.
Yes, that's a limit, not a minimum.
Right. And I would, the only amendment to that, Mr. Chairman, would be there may be one or two on each side that each side wants some additional time. I would hope, if you and I agree that a specific amendment is worthy of a little addition, we could agree to amend the unanimous consent, but that would be just for a minimum number of amendments.
I think that's a reasonable request.
So, Mr. Chairman, I would ask unanimous consent that for the rest of this markup, no amendment shall be debated any longer than 10 minutes on each side.
Without objection, that will be the order. Mr. McNerney, you're now recognized to explain your amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Today I'm offering an important and common sense amendment to help children access health care. I would like to thank the co-sponsor of this amendment, Mr. Tim Murphy of Pennsylvania, for his work to improve children's access to health care and for his commitment to working in a bipartisan fashion. I would also like to recognize Mr. Patrick Murphy of Pennsylvania, who does not sit on this committee but whose legislation is the basis for this amendment. The Children's Health Insurance Program provides health insurance coverage for nearly 11 million children across the United States and 900,000 in my state of California. Providing coverage for our youth is essential to helping children establish strong, healthy lives. Many state CHIP programs implement waiting periods before a child can enroll. These waiting periods occur for a variety of reasons and for a variety of times, ranging anywhere from 3 months in California to 6 months, as it does in Pennsylvania. This amendment would prevent enrollment waiting periods for children who lose insurance because of a parent's job loss. The amendment also prevents waivers if a child loses insurance because of a parent's reduction in work hours, the elimination of retiree health benefits, or if a family's insurance costs exceed 10% of their income. With employment rates that continue to climb as high as 15%.
Would the gentleman yield?
Yes.
The minority is prepared to accept your amendment.
All right. With that, I guess I just want to say thank you again to Mr. Murphy of Pennsylvania. Does the gentleman wish to speak on the behalf of the amendment?
I thank the gentleman for yielding. I just a few seconds here to say, so for members who are to properly understand this, this is one that would say that rather than a child, think of a one-year-old having to wait 6 months for care is half a lifetime. And this is very specific. If they've lost their health insurance, they're under age of two, or the families face significant out-of-pocket medical costs, more than 10% of their income, this would expedite that. So I thank the gentleman for yielding back, and I appreciate members' support.
Would the gentleman yield to me, Mr. McNerney?
Yes.
I want to thank you and all the Murphys that have co-sponsored this amendment. I think it's a very worthwhile, common-sense amendment, and I would urge members to adopt it as well.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Further discussion of the amendment? If not, we'll proceed to a vote. All those in favor of the Murphy-McNerney amendment will say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. The ayes have it and the amendment's agreed to. Mr. Deal, you have an amendment?
Yes, I do, Mr. Chairman. It is ECR Medicaid 001.
Clerk will inform us whether the amendment is to this title and has been available for 2 hours.
It is to this title, and it was submitted in a timely fashion.
Clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3200 offered by Mr. Deal. At the end of subtitle
without objection, the amendment will be considered as read, and the gentleman from Georgia is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This amendment is designed to make sure that there is not an unintended loophole or drafting error in the underlying bill. The reason for the amendment is that the underlying bill would require millions of people to be automatically enrolled in Medicaid without any guarantees that these new enrollees will be United States citizens or certain legal permanent residents as required under current law. Specifically, the section of the underlying bill requires that the state shall accept without further determination the enrollment under the Medicaid program of an individual determined by the commissioner to be a non-traditional Medicaid-eligible individual. However, nowhere in the bill is the commissioner required to apply the existing citizenship and identity verification requirements that exist in the current Medicaid statute. This legislation, the amendment that I'm offering, is simply designed to ensure that the requirements that have been the requirements of the past are maintained in this new legislation. We certainly know that there are approximately 11 plus million individuals who are illegally in our country, and we want to make sure that this taxpayer-sponsored legislation that provides coverage for a variety of individuals does not extend that coverage to people who are not eligible, and that the verification of eligibility is something that is tangible and not simply somebody swearing that they're a citizen with no requirement of proof that they in fact are. We know that the verification requirements that were inserted in the Deficit Reduction Act of 2005 have proven successful, and we want to make sure that this legislation does not either intentionally or unintentionally remove those requirements for citizenship verification in two categories, first being the general category of proof of citizenship for Medicaid eligibility, and then the qualified alien status, where there are 9 categories of aliens who are eligible, that the verification under the SAVE system that is already in place must be applied to determining their eligibility under this legislation as well. The purpose is to ensure that the taxpayers' dollars are well spent and that they are legally the individuals are legally entitled to the benefits. With that, I would yield back.
Mr. Chairman.
Gentleman, yield back his time.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Green.
Mr. Chairman, could I just ask the staff or council, does anything in this bill change any of the requirements that were placed in 2005 or under current law on documenting whether someone's undocumented or not for Medicaid purposes? Do we amend the previous law to eliminate any of those restrictions in this legislation?
I don't believe so.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, the concern I have is that from council, I just wanted to make sure we weren't touching whatever previous law was in place under this new legislation on Medicaid. The states already enforce the restrictions on non-citizens not being eligible for Medicaid.
Right.
Now, I can't sit here and say that somebody doesn't sneak through with a fake Social Security card. Obviously, we need...
The gentleman yield to me?
I'd be glad to yield, Mr. Chairman.
Or to Mr. Pallone. As I understand this amendment, it would require people to show they're citizens. Now, the law is that if you're an undocumented alien, you're not eligible for services under Medicaid, period. And that's not being changed. But this would require people to come in and establish whether they're citizens. And the people who get hurt are U.S. citizens who don't have a passport or can't find their birth certificate. And they go to the hospital, and they're trying to get medical care, and they're not going to be able to get medical care unless they can show they're a U.S. citizen. This amendment, we know, has done a lot of harm. It got to the point where it was being enforced in some areas where children who were born in the United States at the hospital were not being eligible for services as U.S. citizens unless they could prove their citizenship, unless their parents could prove their citizenship. So this is an amendment that is very substantive and harmful to U.S. citizens. If you're an undocumented alien, you're not eligible unless it's an emergency. And if you are brought into an emergency room, I'd like counsel to respond to this. As I understand this amendment, if you're brought into an emergency room, you have to establish whether you're a U.S. citizen. Is that an accurate statement?
Or if you are a qualified alien.
Well, or the counsel said, if you're going to an emergency room to get medical care after an auto accident or whatever, you have to be able to establish that you are a U.S. citizen or a legal alien. I would imagine someone would bleed to death before you can get the documentation.
Would the chairman...
I would certainly oppose the amendment.
Would...
I yield the time back to the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Green, who still has some time available. Mr. Green?
Mr. Green, would you yield?
Mr. Chairman, I'll be glad to yield. You raise the same questions I have, and I'll be glad to yield our chair of our health subcommittee.
Mr. Chairman, I just, you know, just following up on what you said, the problem is that right now, the references that are in here to Section 1903, those provisions about establishing citizenship and what you do, those were all things that were included at the request of the Republicans before, and they are the law now. And what's happening is, as you said, a lot of people who are citizens are not getting care because of these requirements, and there's no evidence that people who are illegal are getting the care. So.
Oh.
I don't see the point of adding another burden when the evidence suggests that illegals can't get the care, citizens are having a hard time getting the care, and we're operating under Republican provisions as how you establish citizenship already. This just adds another layer, maybe, which is not necessary, and is going to make it more of a burden for people who are citizens to get care. It doesn't add anything at all, and I just don't see the point. So that's why I would oppose it. I yield back.
Gentlemen from Texas, yield to me on this 45 seconds. I thank you very much for yielding. The point is that the law now requires if you go in for medical care under Medicaid, you have to show you're a citizen or you have to show you're a legal alien. That's the law. What this amendment would do is that anytime you go into any institution under any circumstances, even in an emergency room, you'd have to establish either citizenship or your right to be in the United States. And the people who have been harmed by the existing law have been U.S. citizens. oftentimes from poor rural areas where they don't have their birth certificate or they don't have their passports. And people are if you're anticipating going in for medical care, you could get that. But if you're not anticipating it, you can be in deep trouble. Mr. Barton.
Mr. Chairman, I rise in support of the amendment. I want to just try to focus the committee's attention on the real world. We put citizenship verification provisions into the Deficit Reduction Act of 2005. Those went into effect in 2006. At the time, there was a great hue and cry that people had lost their birth certificate or they were born before there were birth certificates or whatever, and that they wouldn't be able to prove. So that we added by regulation a voluminous way of alternative verification
because I think it's
besides a birth certificate issued by a county or a state. Well, in the Medicaid SCHIP debate last year, the verification procedure was suspended, and now for SCHIP, children just have their parents have to affirm that they're here in this country legally. It's personal affirmation. That's the standard, personal affirmation. We still have for adults on Medicaid the citizenship verification that we put into place back in 2005. Having said that, Section 1802 of this bill says that the state shall accept without further determination the enrollment under the Medicaid program of an individual determined by the commissioner to be a non-traditional Medicaid eligible individual. The states are going to automatically enroll millions of people, automatically. And what the deal amendment says is, before those millions are automatically enrolled, that we use the verification procedure to make sure that they're eligible. That's all it says. Now, this, you know, people bleeding to death in emergency rooms and all that, that's not happening. In my public hospital in Tarrant County, Texas, in John Peter Smith Hospital, it's somewhat anecdotal, but I believe it to be true, 70% of the births last year were to undocumented residents of Tarrant County, 70%, because JPS has chosen that if you come into that hospital and you're about to have a baby, they're going to deliver that baby. People are not being turned away if they don't walk in with their birth certificate. But what we should do, if we're going to expand Medicaid eligibility to childless adults and all these new, as you put it in the bill, non-traditional Medicaid eligible individuals, it makes sense to insist that the verification procedures that are on the books be used for these, I quote, automatic enrollees. That's all that this amendment does.
Gentlemen, yield.
Yield to Mr. Shimkus.
No, I would just say that CMS allows states to use electronic records such as DMV. We know California provides driver's license to illegal immigrants. They can use those driver's licenses to say they are a citizen. This is a clear amendment to say if you want taxpayer funds to go in this health system for illegal immigrants, then vote no. But if you want the taxpayer on the hook to paying health care for illegal immigrants, then vote against this amendment. It's really simple. And the fact is that states are allowed to waive verification requirements by a statement by a family member. So the choice is clear, and I would yield back to the ranking member.
Gentleman, yield.
Mr. Deal, or Mr. Waldron, I'm sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just real quickly, Oregon was the only state that allowed for an audit to be done on this issue of Medicaid enrollment. And when that audit was done in 2005, the state of Oregon found that 3% of all Medicaid beneficiaries were illegal aliens. And so the 2005 report by the Inspector General at HHS found 46 states and the District of Columbia allowed self-declaration of citizenship for Medicaid, and 27 of those states did not verify citizenship statements at any point. So this is a real issue if you're paying the bill, and we're trying to get to taking care of people who are here legally to make sure they have health coverage. I'd yield back to the ranking member.
Mr.
Mr. Terry.
Thank you. And just to add some local flavor, in Omaha, my sister was actually a social worker who signed up people into the system. And she brought a group of her co-employees to me several years ago and said they aren't even allowed to ask about citizenship. And they knew they were signing up a lot of those that were undocumented. And that's what we're talking about, is taking it to the level where they're actually allowed to ask for verification.
Good coverage. In the Louisville paper.
Gentlemen's time.
I yield back, Mr.
Okay. A chair recognizes himself. Mr. Barton and I had a discussion because right now the verification is in effect. But what I'm concerned about and expressed concern about is the emergency room. And he thought that was, if I can repeat our private conversation, the emergency room is an exceptional situation. And when we passed the CHIP bill, we made a modification for children. Now, I would like to request that unanimous consent that we limit this amendment. Let me put it this way, that the amendment be changed to make an exception for emergency rooms and care and for care for children.
Mr. Chairman, reserving the right to object.
Yes. Gentlemen's recognized the reservation.
I'd like to make an inquiry of counsel in that regard. Mm-hmm. Counsel, is there anything in this amendment that in any way repeals the EMTALA statute, which requires emergency rooms to treat individuals regardless of their status, regardless of whether they have insurance, regardless of any other circumstances? Is there anything in this amendment that would repeal the EMTALA requirements that currently apply to emergency rooms?
No.
So,
gentlemen, yield to me. It won't eliminate the requirement for the emergency room to treat somebody in emergency, but it will eliminate the hospital from getting reimbursed under Medicaid for having given that care. And I'd be loath to do that, because the hospital is not going to be able to verify in an emergency that the person is eligible or is not ineligible.
Mr. Chairman, I reserve the right.
Reserving the right to object.
That I be recognized. Mr. Chairman, I don't know that there's any reimbursement question here. If you're not covered by Medicaid and you go to emergency room, the hospital still doesn't get reimbursed. That's just not an issue. You get the care under EMTALA. You're not reimbursed if you're not covered by Medicaid. And private insurance and other people make up that gap. That's part of the whole problem of eliminating the private system. Nobody's left to fill the gap of people that the emergency room and the hospital are not reimbursed for. So I would just...
A gentleman, yield to me?
I would.
I'm talking to my counsel, and he asserts to me that if you are on Medicaid or you go to emergency room, the Medicaid program pays. Now, you're arguing that you wouldn't be on Medicaid, but there are people who are on Medicaid.
And Mr. Chairman, that would be paid for, and those people wouldn't be impacted by this amendment in any way. And the still has my time.
Well, it's a reservation, so.
I'd yield to the gentleman.
Well, I thank you. I frankly want to re-ask the counsel on it says that no service furnished under this title may be granted, not no reimbursement, no service. On line 16, the second and third words, it's service furnished under this title. So it does seem to me, in answer to Mr. Deal's question, the answer is yes, this amendment does indeed limit the services that can be offered. So I would suggest that the amendment that is being, I think it's a friendly amendment being offered, it might bring us to a place we can vote for it, is indeed needed, because it limits the service that can be offered to anyone who can't show they're documented. So someone who's hit by a car, who doesn't bring their wallet, who's hit by a car, is all alone, doesn't have their family member with them, would have to wait until the service was provided.
Mr. Chairman, if I still control the time, I'd just like to say that question's been asked and answered. There's nothing here that repeals the EMTALA access to emergency care. This is about a question of coverage and taxpayer-funded reimbursement at some future time. You know, the gentleman's amendment would just require documentation to be part of a covered program.
Well, the gentleman, I disagree with you. I hear what you're saying. I will withdraw my unanimous consent request and urge members to oppose the amendment. Now, I was recognized for 5 minutes. And so I want to debate this matter. I just think this is going to be a bureaucratic nightmare for people at emergency rooms of hospitals to try to decide when somebody's brought in unconscious whether they have their birth certificate to show they're a U.S. citizen. And I think the people that are going to be hurt are U.S. citizens who are going to be denied coverage. Now, there may be a requirement for the hospital to give them care, but I think we're putting the hospitals in a very precarious situation. And I don't think it's necessary. Existing law requires that there be a documentation when you sign up in Medicaid. You have to show it. You have time to do it under those circumstances. You don't have time in an emergency room.
Will the gentleman yield?
Who's asking me to yield? Mr. Shattuck.
I guess I'd, on your time with your yield, I'd like to ask counsel again. EMTALA provides that everyone who shows up at an emergency room is entitled to care, and entitled to care before their ability to pay can be verified. If that is not repealed, and I thought I heard counsel say nothing in that was repealed by Mr. Deal's amendment, then I do not understand the concern the chairman is expressing. So, counsel, is there anything in Mr. Deal's amendment that that repeals the requirement under EMTALA that care be provided?
No, but Mr. Weiner brings up the language on lines 15 and 16, which deal with eligibility for an item or service, but the intent of this appears to be to deal with eligibility for medical assistance, which is the payment for it. So I guess the ambiguity here would be, is there any intent in this first sentence?
Well, so what you're saying is that Mr. Weiner's point might result in an issue regarding who actually ultimately pays for the service. But the chairman's point that you might not get that service is not accurate because EMTALA is not repealed. I guess my response to that would be there are big issues about payment for services rendered under EMTALA right now. Many of us believe those costs are shifted to people who pay for insurance. I don't think we're dealing with the cost issue. The concern of the chairman was, are people going to be denied care as they're sitting there bleeding in an emergency room? The answer to which is, under EMTALA, they will not be denied that care.
Well, reclaiming my time, I am concerned that hospitals all over the country are closing emergency rooms because they cannot deal with the uncompensated care that they give when they have an emergency room. They have to give it. We've agreed to that. So a lot of them are trying to become specialty hospitals or just don't have emergency rooms open. And that just means that when people go to the emergency rooms that are open, there are such congestion of people coming in for all sorts of reasons that it would be a bureaucratic nightmare for them not to know whether they're going to get reimbursed if somebody is a U.S. citizen and would appear to be on Medicaid, and they make the judgment that that's the situation. I just think that Mr. Weiner has pointed out, and I'll yield to him if he wants to go further on this issue, but I think he's pointed out a flaw that is a serious one. And I hear the gentleman saying perhaps we didn't provide emergency care to people who may be undocumented. That may be all to the good, but that's not the law. They have to get the emergency care. Hospitals have to give it, and we are having the unintended consequences, which now are foreseeable because it's a reality, that we're getting fewer and fewer places available for anybody. And most of the people who need it are U.S. citizens to get the care and to be able to have the institution get the payment for the care. Ms. Baldwin, do you want me to yield to you on that?
I just wanted to add that, you know, when Wisconsin was implementing the current law, they took very close track of the problems they encountered, and there were about 19,000 people, the vast majority of them U.S. citizens, who were unable to secure a passport or a birth certificate. Maybe don't live in the same state or county that they were born and had to seek that documentation. 19,000 U.S. citizens in Wisconsin turned away for care in various settings as that paperwork was being assembled and put together. I would hope you agree, unintended consequences that injure the health of U.S. citizens, and I would therefore strongly urge my colleagues to oppose this amendment.
My time has expired. Are we ready for the vote? Then let's proceed to I believe it will be a roll call vote, so let's go to a roll call vote.
Mr. Waxman.
No.
Mr. Waxman votes no. Mr. Markey. Mr. Markey, no. I'm sorry, Mr. Dingell. Mr. Dingell, no. Mr. Boucher. Mr. Pallone. Mr. Pallone, no. Mr. Gordon. Mr. Gordon votes no. Mr. Rush. Ms. Eshoo. Ms. Eshoo, no. Mr. Stupak. Mr. Stupak, no. Mr. Engel. Mr. Green. Mr. Green, no. Ms. DeGette. Ms. DeGette, no. Mrs. Capps. Mr. Doyle. Mr. Doyle, no. Ms. Harmon. Ms. Harmon, no. Ms. Schakowsky. Ms. Schakowsky, no. Mr. Gonzalez. Mr. Gonzalez, no. Mr. Inslee. Mr. Inslee, no. Ms. Baldwin. Ms. Baldwin, no. Mr. Ross. Mr. Ross votes aye. Mr. Weiner. Mr. Weiner, no. Excuse me. Mr. Matheson. Mr. Matheson, aye. Mr. Butterfield. Mr. Butterfield votes no. Mr. Melanson. Mr. Melanson, aye. Mr. Barrow. Mr. Barrow, aye. Mr. Hill. Ms. Matsui. Ms. Matsui, no. Mrs. Christensen. Mrs. Christensen, no. Ms. Castor. Ms. Castor, no. Mr. Sarbanes. Mr. Sarbanes, no. Mr. Murphy of Connecticut. Mr. Murphy, no. Mr. Space. Mr. McNerney. Ms. Sutton. Ms. Sutton, no. Mr. Braley. Mr. Braley, no. Mr. Welch. Mr. Welch, no. Mr. Barton. Mr. Barton, aye. Mr. Hall. Mr. Hall, aye. Mr. Upton. Mr. Upton, aye. Mr. Stearns. Mr. Stearns, aye. Mr. Deal. Mr. Deal, aye. Mr. Whitfield. Mr. Whitfield, aye. Mr. Shimkus. Mr. Shimkus, aye. Mr. Shattuck. Mr. Shattuck, aye. Mr. Blunt. Mr. Blunt, aye. Mr. Buoyer. Mr. Radonovich. Mr. Radonovich, aye. Mr. Pitts. Mr. Pitts, aye. Ms. Bono Mack. Ms. Bono Mack, aye. Mr. Walden. Mr. Walden, aye. Mr. Terry. Mr. Terry, aye. Mr. Rogers. Mr. Rogers, aye. Mrs. Myrick. Mrs. Myrick, aye. Mr. Sullivan. Mr. Sullivan, aye. Mr. Murphy of Pennsylvania. Mr. Murphy, aye. Mr. Burgess. Mr. Burgess, aye. Ms. Blackburn. Ms. Blackburn, aye. Mr. Gingrey. Mr. Gingrey, aye. Mr. Scalise? Mr. Scalise, aye.
Mr. Rush?
Mr. Rush is not recorded. Mr. Rush, no. Ms. Capps? Ms. Capps, no. Mr. McNerney, I'm sorry. Mr. McNerney, no. Mr. Boyer?
Aye.
Mr. Boyer, aye. Mr. Space? Mr. Space votes no.
You're missing Engel.
Mr. Hill? Mr. Hill, aye.
Will the clerk call the roll of those who have not yet responded to the vote? Call the names of those who have not been reported.
Mr. Boucher. Mr. Engel.
Clerk will call them.
I'm checking, Mr. Chairman. I believe that's everyone, Mr. Chairman.
Everyone is. Mm-hmm. Any member wish to respond to the vote who has not voted? Any member wish to change his or her vote? Then the clerk will tally the vote and report it.
Ready.
Yes.
On that vote, Mr. Chairman, there were 28 ayes and 29 noes.
28 ayes, 29 noes. The amendment is not agreed to. So an amendment now on the Democratic side. Ms. Baldwin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have an amendment at the desk. It's actually two amendments. Should be Baldwin 4001 and Baldwin 3002.
Does the clerk have the amendment?
I have the amendment, Mr. Chairman.
May I ask you whether the, before you report the amendment, whether the amendment is to this title and has been available for 2 hours?
It is.
The amendment qualifies. Clerk will report the amendment.
Yes, sir. Amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3200 offered by Ms. Baldwin of Wisconsin.
Without objection, I ask unanimous consent that the amendment be considered read.
Without objection, the amendment will be considered as read. The gentlelady is recognized.
Mr. Chairman, to reserve a point of order.
Mr. Scalise reserves a point of order.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This amendment is actually the combination of two amendments that I've been asked to offer together. Both of which seek to improve in this bill how the Medicaid program works for our country's most vulnerable children and young people. In the First Amendment, I'm seeking to expand the use of a type of foster care known as therapeutic foster care. This is a special type of care for the most vulnerable children in our foster care system. These are children with severe mental and emotional health needs who have disabilities, chronic illnesses, and have been or who may have been the victims of abuse or violence. Without these programs, many of these children would be forced to live in institutions without having their mental health needs met and at a much higher cost to states and localities. Currently, many states rely on a patchwork of funding for therapeutic foster care.
Would the gentlelady yield? We're the minority. the minority is prepared to accept the amendment because of all the cheering going on outside.
I'll add my cheers to that, and I would yield back.
We have further discussion of the amendment. Are we ready for the vote? All those in favor of the amendment will say aye. 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 Opposed, no. The ayes have it, and the amendment is agreed to. Mr. Rogers, you have an amendment?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have an amendment to the desk. I believe it's Rogers number 50.
Clerk will inform us if the amendment is qualified by virtue of the section and the amount of time it's been available.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. The amendment is timely, and it is to this division.
Without objection, the amendment will be considered as read, and the gentleman from Michigan is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think we can all agree that comparative effectiveness research can be a useful resource for doctors and their patients, but it should not be used as a tool to limit or deny coverage of treatments. This bill creates an entire new federal regime to conduct CE research. Alarmingly, the bill has no restrictions on how the federal government can use this research. This is a dangerous open-door policy that will almost certainly lead to comparative effectiveness research being used to make coverage decisions. Here's what CE can teach us: what treatments are generally more effective than others, which procedures might work better for particular disease than others, or which drugs have a bigger impact on treating one disease over another. But this is important. Comparative effectiveness research is about general average assumptions. It can't determine anything about an individual patient with a unique condition looking for a unique treatment. We cannot allow the federal government to use a calculator or a bureaucratic standard to get in the middle of patients and doctors. Here's some examples of how they do it in other government-run systems. 23-year-old British woman was diagnosed with cervical cancer. She had asked for a pap smear 3 times and was denied by the National Institute for Clinical Excellence, their version of comparative effectiveness research, because it only provides service to women over the age of 25. And they do that for cost reasons, not because it's best for that patient or respects the doctor-patient relationship. A 36-year-old woman, oh, by the way, that woman did get cervical cancer at age 23. A 36-year-old Ontario woman was diagnosed with stage 4 colon cancer. Her doctor suggested a cancer treatment that targets cancer cells exclusively. Unfortunately, the Canadian government would not cover that drug on the claim that the treatment was unproven, even though that drug is a standard cancer treatment covered by insurance companies in the United States. A 46-year-old Montreal woman was denied access to the only cancer drug that would keep her alive as she battled a very tough form of colon cancer. The drug is a standard treatment in the United States, but Canada denied the treatment because it said, quote, "We wanted to see a more prolonged survival rate." The government made a life and death decision on that patient. And the reason they do it, it's because the only way that the government can control costs is by denying access or denying treatments. These are tragic stories. These patients deserve better, and I believe Americans deserve better, Mr. Chairman, and shouldn't be subjected to government rationing health care. My amendment is very simple. It would prohibit the federal government from using comparative effectiveness research to deny or ration health care. It's common sense protection that must be included in this bill. Only doctors and patients should be making the decisions about what treatments are best, not a government bureaucrat. Mr. Chairman,
would the gentleman yield?
Would the gentleman yield?
Behind
who's
you.
Who's seeking recognition? Yeah. Mr. Shimkus?
Thank you. I thank my colleagues. This is a great amendment. The history behind what happened in the British system is that NICE was established to calculate comparative effectiveness. It was designed for the same purposes as we're saying comparative effectiveness being designed today, to help us get better quality care. What NICE has turned out to be is the rationing program for the British government. And there are horror stories on both sides, but it's undeniable that comparative effectiveness, the same arguments we hear today, was used to establish this federal bureaucracy or this national bureaucracy in the UK, which rations care. This amendment says you cannot use these stats, these figures, to ration care. And I applaud the gentleman from Michigan, and I yield back my time to him.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman.
Does someone else seek recognition?
Will the gentleman yield? Would this amendment apply also, would it limit private health insurance companies from doing the same thing based on this information?
As it is drafted, it takes care of the government plan, and by your bill, all plans must comply with the government plan.
So, but I notice that the language does say by the federal government. It seems anyone who would to do the plain reading would assume that you're trying to exclude anyone who's not the federal government.
Again, in your bill, all plans must comply with the government plan. So the answer is yes.
So a private insurance company couldn't use this information either. Great.
Gentleman, yield back the balance of his time.
Mr. Chairman.
Gentleman, yield back his time. Mr. Dingell.
I seek recognition to strike the requisite number of words.
Gentleman is recognized for 5 minutes.
I'd like the attention of the author of the amendment because this is a friendly comment. But as always, when we're considering amendments and legislation, the devil's in the details. Now, the amendment, as I note, would prevent the research produced by the Center for Comparative Effectiveness Research from being used to deny or ration care. Now, I appreciate the concerns of the gentleman, and I don't want this research misused, and my feelings on that are the same as his. But I want to note that not all denials are a misuse of research. And I'd like to give the gentleman a couple of concerns here that I think he should share with me. First, it was a comparative effectiveness study that showed that Vioxx actually caused heart attacks, more of them. Now, there's a question. Do we really want to limit that use of science? Another study showed that Fen-Phen, a drug for weight loss, actually caused heart valve damage. Again, do we want to limit that kind of science and that kind of use of science? Now, fortunately, these kinds of research findings are rare. But if a study shows that a treatment is dangerous, should we be denying ourselves the ability to deny that treatment? So I understand what my good friend from Michigan is trying to do, and I share his concerns. But I also am concerned that it is a bit too broad. And I'm wondering if my friend would be willing to strike the word to deny, which would enable us to support the amendment, because it would say that research that says that an amendment, rather that a particular treatment or a particular kind of pharmaceutical is in fact dangerous, would probably be precluded under the amendment. I yield.
Does the gentleman yield? Thank you for your time. And I respect the gentleman greatly, and I couldn't disagree more with his interpretation of the language. The FDA stepped in those cases, and this would not prohibit that at all from happening.
Well,
and more importantly, it protects the doctor-patient relationship. If a doctor knows that Fen-Phen is a problem through comparative research, they're not going to use that in the treatment of their patients. And I wouldn't take my word for it. If you'll yield to Dr. Gingrey, I think he can give you a doctor's perspective as well, if the gentleman would be so inclined.
I'm sorry the gentleman and I disagree on the interpretation of his language. But I think if the gentleman could accord with me on removing the words denied, we could support the amendment. Otherwise, I have to oppose it. And I'm sure my colleagues on this side will join me in opposition.
Will the gentleman yield?
I think the amendment of the gentleman has a great deal of merit if it has that changed. I want to support it both as his friend and because I'm convinced that this is a sound amendment.
Now, will the chairman emeritus yield for
30 seconds? I'll yield. Who seeks for me to yield to him? I'm glad to yield to the gentleman, of course.
And I thank the gentleman for yielding. My comment is this, that you mentioned, in fact, several drugs that were approved after market, after FDA approval, to be harmful to patients. And, of course, the FDA moved pretty darn quickly to take those drugs off of the market. And in fact, that's the whole purpose of the FDA, to make sure products that have been approved that are found to be harming patients, and in fact, in some cases, even causing their death, that these products are removed. And the other thing, of course, is you might say self-policing. Physicians, you know, every physician is practicing under the Hippocratic Oath in the first place, do no harm, and clearly is not going to be prescribing medication that would harm
patients. I can't yield further to the gentleman, and with respect, I'd simply observe physicians are deceived just like everybody else is. And when we have research that says that certain practices are dangerous or certain pharmaceuticals are dangerous, we ought to permit that research to be communicated to the doctors so that they can put it to work and so that they can achieve the help of research. Because remember, doctors' major function is the application of scientific research and new learning in the area of science with regard to the profession of which they are a very important and valuable part. I yield back the balance of my time.
Gentleman yields back the balance of his time. Further discussion? Ms. Baldwin? The chair would yield to himself to see, because I've been listening to this discussion, and see if we could come to terms on this. Mr. Rogers?
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman.
The examples that Mr. Dingell pointed out were FDA examples. Your amendment says that the research could not be used by the federal government to deny or ration care. And I think he was pointing out that there's sometimes information where we ought to deny care when we find it's harmful. So one way to resolve this is just to strike the word deny and say be used by the federal government to ration care. And then we won't have that problem. Is that something that you could accept?
No, sir, and I tell you, that's just an absolute philosophical difference here, unfortunately, that we run into. Because in the cases that I gave you, and the way that the NICE board in the United Kingdom operates is they use it to deny care. They denied the young lady pap smears when she knowingly asked for them three different times.
You're, of course, looking at...
And so what we're saying is a comparative effectiveness research can be made available, and a doctor can take that into the course of his or her practice. That we want to happen. But for the government to deny coverage based on the effectiveness research for, gee, you can't, you know, 19-year-old cancer recipient, you're statistically you shouldn't get that treatment. We're not gonna do it. They do it in the United Kingdom. They do it in Canada. There's lots and lots and lots.
I hear what you're saying, and I agree.
Philosophically, I think we're just not gonna agree on this.
Yeah, I hear what you're saying, and I agree with what you're saying. You're saying we shouldn't deny care to ration, or to use this information in a way that would give care that people need. But deny care when we find out that a procedure is harmful is something that we would want the federal government to do. I don't think we'd have a philosophical difference.
Mr. Chairman, that's not denying care. That's the practice of good care. You don't do more harm to your patient. You wouldn't give them a treatment that you know is harmful to that patient.
Well, if you do what you suggested is being done elsewhere, that is bad medicine as well. Mr. Weiner?
Let me just take another stab. Just what you described is rationing. They didn't say no pap smears. They just said not for this person, but they'll give it to this person. I think what the offer being made by Mr. Dingell, I think, gets to where you want to go. It prevents them from making a decision that they're not going to allow something that's harmful, but still allows them to say, you know, that prevents them from saying you get it or you don't. I think it does kind of get there by just striking it. Rationing would be left in, which would say they can't do what you described. I mean, I just one more thrust to trying to get there to a compromise.
And would the gentleman yield?
Oh, of course.
And again, just why I disagree, they were denied access because the research said statistically, doesn't mean it won't happen, but statistically it's not very likely to happen. Therefore, we're going to use the calculator and not the doctor to make the determination. So
I
do think it's denying care, and I just feel pretty passionately about it as a cancer survivor myself. The
chairman reclaims his time to give you another idea to look at it. Why don't we say government to deny care that may be harmful or ration care? Because you want to make sure that we're not denying care that's beneficial.
Again, Mr. Chairman, I don't read the amendment the same way you do. And again, as somebody who would have fit the criteria to be denied care, I feel extremely passionate about this.
So you're not interested in
no, sir, I'm really not. I apologize, but in this one, okay. As somebody who has been in this boat and would have fit the statistics where I would have been denied care under a government system, I passionately believe we better send a very clear signal.
You would have been denied helpful care, not harmful care. Anybody else wish to be recognized? If not, Dr. Christensen.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I object to the amendment based on the fact that the comparative effectiveness research is designed to just report on those treatments that are most effective and in no way dictates to physicians or other providers which treatment they should or should not use. And the same way that a harmful treatment being made known to a provider would enable them to make a decision not to use that medicine, favorable treatments, effective treatments being made known through comparative effectiveness research will allow the provider to use that information, but there is no place in here that would cause a denial or rationing. And remember, we're not operating under the British system. We're not creating a single payer here. It's an atmosphere where people are free to choose their insurance coverage. We will be offering an amendment on CER that perhaps we'd ask our colleague to consider supporting, which may address some of his issues. And I'd yield to Mr. Weiner if he still wanted to be recognized. Thanks.
Gentlelady yields to Mr. Sarbanes.
I thank the gentlelady for yielding. I think our concern about this amendment is, on its face, it seems pretty straightforward and intuitive. And in the context in which you placed it, it has some attraction, I guess. But I'm concerned about the way it could be interpreted. And you've heard one expression of concern about the interpretation that could be made with respect to this amendment that might prevent you from taking steps with respect to harmful care. I can envision a scenario where, as a result of research kind of flowing through the system, determination would be made that there's now a more effective kind of treatment that should be paid for, because the research shows that it's getting very good results, and it becomes a kind of new treatment to replace an old treatment. But replacing the old treatment with the new, replacing the old treatment with something more effective under this language could be interpreted as denying care, because now maybe you're not going to reward for that old treatment anymore, and so you're stopping progress in terms of more effective treatment. Sure.
Well, gentlemen, that is, you have just hit on my biggest concern, because that old treatment may apply if a doctor looks at that particular case and says, you know what, this is the right course of action, not the new treatment. And a one-size-fits-all is the most dangerous way you can practice medicine. It's dangerous. People will die. And that's why if you look at cancer rates in Canada, in the United Kingdom, and compare them to the United States, they die a lot more frequently than we do on certain cancers, because they say, well, we have a new treatment, the old treatment can't do it, even though the doctor may say, this is the right treatment for my patient. So that's why, I feel pretty strongly about this, and I think you have hit on the one reason why we ought to be very careful.
Well, reclaiming my time, if you take your perspective to the logical extreme, you can never do anything to improve the sort of constellation of treatments that are out there and make judgments about the kinds of treatment that ought to be supported versus something else. And that's the interpretation that concerns me here, and that's why I would oppose it. And I yield back to the gentlelady.
The gentlelady yields back her time. Mr. Rogers, you want to close?
Mr. Chairman.
Are we ready for the vote?
Mr. Chairman.
The problem is that we've had more than 10 minutes on the Democratic side, and under the unanimous consent, we're supposed to have 10 minutes on each side. Are you ready to vote? Yeah. All those in favor of the Rogers Amendment will say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no.
No.
The ayes appear to have it.
We'd like a roll call vote, Mr. Chairman.
Well, no, wait. You have it.
Wait a minute.
The ayes have it.
Oh, the ayes have it. Then we don't want a roll call vote.
And the amendment is agreed to.
I was asleep at the switch.
Okay. We now have an amendment on the Democratic side. Mr. Stupak.
Mr. Chairman, I have an amendment at desk. It's Stupak 006.
Actually, it's the new one, so it's
well, go make sure it's the right one. Make sure it's the right one.
Clerk, have the amendment.
1001.
1001. That is it.
It's
okay, get no, it. Go get it.
All right. It's the
Mr. Chairman, let me pass until we get the right one. Apparently, there has been.
We have it.
You do have it.
Yeah, we have Braley Stupak.
All right,
001.
Go with that one.
Which one?
Braley, get ready.
001.
Is
Mr. Braley and I are offering this. Do you want to go first?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Braley, you have
an
amendment?
I reserve a point of order.
Gentlemen.
Reserve point of order.
Oh, yes. Gentlemen reserves a point of order. Mr. Braley, your amendment is at the desk that you and Mr. Stupak are offering. I inquire of the clerk if the amendment has been available for 2 hours and is to this title.
It was, and it is.
Okay. Without objection, the amendment will be considered as read. And, Mr. Braley, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for working with Mr. Stupak and I on this amendment, which will improve safety in our nation's long-term care facilities and begin developing measures of quality care for Alzheimer's treatment and improve the way we measure quality in skilled nursing facilities. Every day we hear news stories about unsafe food and outbreaks of foodborne illness, and this committee has worked hard to address this issue. Approximately 76 million cases of foodborne illness occur every year in the United States, and of those cases, more than 325,000 people are hospitalized and about 5,000 deaths occur. Foodborne illness is a serious public health threat to Americans of all ages, but older Americans are among those at highest risk. Despite these dangers, there are no minimum regulations for training of food service directors at retirement homes or at other long-term care facilities. This amendment would require the director of food services at long-term care facilities to be a certified dietary manager or a registered dietitian. Currently, federal regulations mandate that the facility must at least consult with a qualified dietitian. However, the director of food services has no required minimum qualifications. Our amendment will ensure that food directors in long-term care facilities have certification that gives them the skills needed to prevent foodborne illness. Secondly, this amendment will require the Secretary of HHS, acting through the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality, to develop a core set of quality indicators for the provision of medical services to people with Alzheimer's disease and other forms of dementia. This amendment will also require the Secretary to develop a plan for implementing the indicators to measure the quality of care provided for people with these conditions by physicians, hospitals.
Would the gentleman yield?
Well, I'm in the process of advocating for the amendment, so I would be happy to yield if
well,
you just let me finish.
We're of some confusion. We have one amendment that is Section 1433 that we're prepared to accept, but then we have a Section 1446 and a subtitle study on a 5-star quality rating system. Is your amendment just the 1443, or does it include all the other sections?
If the gentleman will yield. That's why their confusion came in. We've been asked to try to put amendments together sort of like in blocks so we can move this markup quicker. We're both dealing with nursing homes. Mr. Braley is on food safety. Mine is on the 5-star quality rating of nursing homes. And so we put these two together. That's the confusion on
there
it.
It's an in block.
And I'll speak, yeah, it's in block. It's
yes.
Braley Stupak. That's why we had the confusion. And I'll give 2 minutes on my part of it, if you don't mind. If Mr. Braley would yield, and then we can move this amendment along, hopefully.
Okay,
yes.
Well, we are prepared to accept the Braley part of the amendment. And I don't know that we have a position on the STUPAC part of the amendment. So
let me give you the two-cent words on the STUPAC part.
We'll listen with interest and probably accept yours, too.
All right. Well, I thank Mr. Braley and I thank Mr. Waxman and thank the ranking member. During the last days of the last administration, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid rolled out a five-star quality rating system for nursing homes. The five-star system set out to rate nursing facilities just like restaurants. Give them a star for every rating to help consumers make decisions on where to place their loved ones. We never had any hearings on nursing home standards since they were put in 1987. As chairman of Oversight Investigations, we held a hearing this last year, the only hearing in 22 years, and we found a number of concerns, problems. The nursing home industry has been working with us to try to come up with a good rating system to make sure we're protecting our seniors. So all my five-star system amendment does is to have the GO conduct a study on the five-star system to determine, among other things, whether the composite star rating should be eliminated in favor of multi-dimensional system under which a star rating is designed to assign to each individual domain, determine whether an appeals process should be implemented for the five-star rating system to address situations in which questionable, inaccurate, or incomplete data has been identified.
Would the gentleman yield?
Yes.
We have studied your study amendment, and we're prepared to accept it and stop studying it.
That is great.
You're so persuasive.
We'll see how I am on the next ones.
Are we any further discussion? Not. We'll proceed.
Mr. Chairman, I remove my objection.
The gentleman withdraws his point of order. We'll proceed to the vote. All those in favor of the Braley-STUPAC amendment will say aye. Aye. Opposed, no. The ayes have it, and the amendments agreed to.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Barton.
I have an amendment at the desk. It's amendment number 326. EC Study 001. Barton, EC Study 001. And, Mr. Chairman, while they're finding my amendment, it's my understanding that at approximately noon we're going to break for lunch so that the Republicans can go to the special Republican conference on health care. Is that your willingness also?
Gentlemen, you yield to me. We've discussed this. The Republican members wish to attend a Republican conference meeting at noon, so we will accommodate that request and break for an hour.
That'd be great.
And I hope they're serving lunch at your meeting because we're going to go out and get lunch on our side.
Okay. Well, I don't know what we may be serving crow at our meeting, but we will provide some sustenance.
Okay. I ask the clerk whether this amendment is to this title and has been available. Requisite time.
It is to this title and it's been available at the appropriate amount.
Without objection, the Barton Amendment will be considered as read. And the gentleman from Texas is recognized for 5 minutes.
Before I begin, let me recognize the distinguished chairman of the Ways and Means Committee, Mr. Rangel, who is in the room. Since this amendment relates to the jurisdiction of his committee, it's good that he would be in attendance when I discuss it. Mr. Chairman, under the pending bill, there is a tax on American citizens, depending on their income status. If this bill goes into effect, there would be an immediate tax on surtax on incomes of citizens who make between $350,000 and $500,000 per year. There would be a 1% tax for citizens who make between $500,000 and $1 million. There would be a 1.5% tax. And for citizens who make over $1 million, there would be a 5.4% surtax. Those taxes on the lower two income brackets would double in the year 2013 if there is a study by the OMB that determines that certain savings have not occurred. What the Barton Amendment does is direct the study to find that regardless of the savings, that the taxes on the lower two income brackets, the tax increases do not go into effect. So the effect of the Barton Amendment, if adopted, would be that beginning in 2013, only those citizens who make over $1 million would have their taxes increased by the surtax. The reason that we don't just repeal the tax increase, and that's why I'm glad the chairman of the Ways and Means Committee is here, is because we don't have jurisdiction to repeal in this committee the tax increase, but we do have jurisdiction over studies. So we use the study as a hook to at least save those citizens who make more than who make less than $1 million to try to save them some money beginning in the year 2013. So this is the $1 million taxpayer protection amendment, those that make less than $1 million.
Mr. Chairman.
Gentleman yields back his time.
I would yield,
would the gentleman
to Mr. Waldron.
I just have to speak up on this in support of it. If you look at the chart that is being held up here, my home state of Oregon would have the second highest income tax rate in the world. And we already have the second, I think the highest income tax, marginal tax rate in the United States of any state, which is a great benefit for Mr. Inslee's state because we're having to build a whole new bridge so people can move to Washington State. You would think our tax policy was written by the Vancouver Chamber of Commerce, which is a state issue. This only adds to that pressure and I think is one of the reasons why Oregon is second to Michigan in unemployment. And so I will be supporting the gentleman's amendment.
And seeing no hands on my side, I would yield back.
Gentleman yields back his time. Mr. Pallone.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm not sure I know exactly how Mr. Barton is trying to create jurisdiction over this issue, you know, in this committee. I really don't think it belongs here. But the basic problem that I see is, you know, he's doing some kind of gimmick to undercut the work done by the Revenue Committee, and it is sort of interesting that the chairman, Mr. Rangel, is here. What I want to point out, and the reason I oppose this amendment, is that from the very beginning of this debate, when President Obama talked about the need for health care reform, he pointed out that a good part of the cost, the paygo, if you will, was going to be from cuts in existing programs, Medicare in particular. But at the same time, there was going to be a need for new revenue. And the reason there was a need for new revenue was because in order to cover more people and provide assistance to middle-income families through a subsidy, at least up front in the beginning, a certain amount of money was going to have to be available. Down the road, as the health reform kicks in, we save more and more money as time goes on. But at least initially, there would have to be a certain amount of money provided. And that, you know, that figure was about $1 trillion, and part of it would be paid for through program cuts and part of it through new revenue. And I think that we would be kidding ourselves if we didn't realize or acknowledge that some revenue source is needed. Now, if you look at a revenue source, I think that what the Ways and Means Committee came up with is probably the most responsible way of doing this that I can possibly imagine. If you look at this surcharge, it only applies to the top 1.2% of all households in the United States. It would have no effect on 98.8% of all households in the United States. Now, of those families making between $350,000 and $1 million, they would contribute less than 1% of their annual income to help provide access to affordable health care for all Americans. I don't think that's much of a contribution when you're going to cover all these people who have no insurance, plus a significant number of people who would get a subsidy to help them pay and make insurance affordable to them. We're a community. Everyone should help to a certain extent. And I think that this is the least offensive way of doing it. I know it's not before our committee. Maybe we shouldn't even be talking about it today. But of all the proposals I've seen out there, this is the least offensive. And if you think that we're going to be able to do this without some new source of income, I think you're kidding yourself. And I'll point out, you know, I don't represent a poor district. I have a lot of the people that would be impacted by this. But I still think it's important to recognize that this is a good way of doing it and that something has to be done. This is not all going to be paid for through program cuts. I yield to the gentleman from New York.
And the gentleman fails to point out one other thing. American citizens' taxes are going to go down as a result of this bill. And let me explain why. Because right now your states are paying too much for health care because there's no containment.
The Republicans are acting like British parlamentarians. Ration your mirth.
So long as they don't start acting like South Korean ones, I'll be fine. The cost to citizens are going to go down because the amount that they're paying for their products won't have inflated health care costs built in. The amount of uninsured that are walking to hospital emergency rooms are going to go down, so more efficient care will be provided. The amount for cities like mine and states that have shares of Medicaid are going to go down. So overall, tax expenditures are going to go down, 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 and so are non-tax expenditures. The way Americans should look at this effort is, will their overall cost of life be reduced or go up? Healthcare is on the track to double in the next 5 years, to double. If we don't fix that, everything we have is going to go up in cost. So the question is not what column it's going to go up. Some may go up a little, but everything is going to go down appreciably a lot. So I welcome the chance to study this. Now, you can write in an amendement that says, here's what the conclusion of the study shall be. The fact is that health care costs are driving everything in this country to be too expensive. When you buy a car, you're paying a tax. When you're buying food, you're paying a tax. When you go into the office, you're paying a tax. You want those taxes to stay in place. We say no, that's not a good policy, and we're trying to change it. And what this amendment refers to is the effort to make...
Where the gentleman yield.
I don't control the time, but bring it on, Chickie.
I thank the gentleman for yielding. I think the gentleman spent a sufficient amount of time.
Gentleman's time has expired. Let me
Chairman,
go to Mr. Blunt, and perhaps he can yield to you on the last 5 minutes of debate.
I'll yield time here to my colleagues who wanted us after I make a couple of comments. One is that there is no study that I'm aware of this proposal that indicates that there's anything that saves money or bends the cost curve. We heard the CBO testify with conclusively that the cost curve does not go down. The gentleman's suggestion that somehow this is guaranteed to contain cost is not supported by any information I'm aware of. And the tax here we're talking about is a tax that absolutely falls on most of the small businesses in America that get beyond that $200,000 or $300,000 level. And their tax would be impacted by this dramatically, the job-creating engine of the country. I think the former chairman's amendment, the ranking member's amendment, just simply, if there is going to be this tax, tries to move it into an area where it doesn't impact the job-creating aspects of small businesses that do have income that might exceed $250,000 or $300,000. We had a meeting with a number of those people this week about the 8% surcharge that was in the bill if you didn't provide insurance. All of them saw these as job costing measures at a time when they'd like to be creating jobs, and certainly the economy would like to see those jobs created. I yield to the gentleman from Georgia.
And I thank the gentleman from Missouri for yielding. And I think, as I understand the gentleman's amendment, it basically to say that if this surtax, particularly on those making less than $1 million a year, many of whom, maybe a third, are small businessmen and women, if it's found by a study in 2012 that more than enough taxes have been raised for paying for this Health Care Reform Act, then we should not continue to tax these individuals. The speaker was asked the same question on a Sunday morning talk show about a week ago, and her response, Mr. Chairman, was, well, you know, we would use that excess money to pay down the deficit. Well, goodness gracious, it would seem to me that we would leave that money in the pockets of the small businessmen and women so they could continue to create jobs, and we have more and more revenue coming in. So this is a pretty straightforward amendment.
The gentleman
yield? Got enough money. And
that's
let me just also say that you've got these same people, the Democratic majority, are going to go after these same people to pay for other things, so you better save some for later.
I yield to the gentleman from Florida.
I thank my colleague. Mr. Weiner says that we're going to lower health care costs with this bill. Now, this is a study by the Joint Economic Committee Senator Brownback's a ranking member on the Republican, bipartisan. Mr. Wiener should probably look at this graph. This is a small graph, but it shows, in fact, that under this health care bill, health care costs are going up almost exponentially. So I don't think there's any evidence to support your idea that this bill here will bring down health care costs. In fact, it's going to increase it dramatically. And so I think, you know, when you look at what the President said, that he wouldn't support any health care bill that did not bring health care costs down, I don't know how, in fact, he could support this bill based upon what the Joint Economic Committee has published in this very thorough analysis showing health care costs going up.
I yield to the gentleman from Louisiana, and then if there's time, the gentleman from Illinois.
Appreciate the gentleman from Missouri yield. And for anybody to suggest that if this bill passes, taxes will go down, I suggest they actually go and read the bill, because if you look right here in Section 401, it's called Tax on Individuals Without Acceptable Health Care Coverage. So that means if this new health care czar that's being created doesn't deem your plan acceptable, they can actually impose a 2.5% tax on your income. It's such a large tax that the Congressional Budget Office actually said here in this room, unfortunately, the public was kicked out of the meeting. It was not a meeting that was open to the public, but I was there, and the Congressional Budget Office said that one section alone is going to add $29 billion in new taxes onto the backs of people who are uninsured today. And most of those people are people making well below $50,000 a year. If you just look at the Congressional Budget Office's own testimony, you know, maybe some radical blog is telling you you're not going to pay more taxes. The Congressional Budget Office has said you're going to pay about $800 billion in new taxes if this bill passes, not to mention the exponential cost increases that go up and the rationing of care. And I yield back to the gentleman.
I yield to the gentleman from Illinois.
Dan, I just want to follow up. The CBO Director Doug Elmendorf said that Obama's cost savings are an illusion. And that's the nonpartisan Congressional Budget Office. An illusion, so I wouldn't allude to savings.
Gentleman's time has expired. The chair recognizes himself for the last 5 minutes of debate on this amendment. This is a very confusing amendment. One would think that this shouldn't even be in the jurisdiction of this committee, but we checked with the parliamentarian, and the parliamentarian said that it was crafted in a way that allowed it to be germane. And I don't know if that's why the chairman of the Ways and Means Committee is here or not, but this is strange. The bill says that if we don't achieve the savings that we need to achieve, then we would look to revenues. Now, this amendment says if we do a study, we're going to determine that if the savings, if we do achieve savings, that we're going to reduce the revenues. Well, this the whole bill that we have is paid for out of programmatic savings. That's cuts in Medicare and Medicaid, and since that's not enough, new revenues. Well, this amendment would reduce the revenues. Well, if we make a reduction in the revenue side, then we have to look to see whether we're going to get the savings. If we don't get the savings, this amendment could cost us several hundred billion dollars if it worked. And there's a lot of confusion whether it works. So I think this is a message amendment. I don't even understand the message. But the impact of this amendment would be very destructive of the bill that we have before us. And if the study showed that we didn't achieve the savings, and or if we did achieve the savings, we would then make a decision, or we would delegate this decision, as to how much money would be available. And then we'd have to go make additional cuts in Medicare and Medicaid. That may or may not be possible. So I just think that I urge members to oppose this amendment. Well, it's what we call gimmicky. It says it's doing something. It says the OMB would find at least $700 billion in savings had been generated. And if they did, we'd change the surtax, and individuals making less than $1 million would never face a tax. Well, I don't know what the revenue provisions will be when we get to the House floor. No one wants to raise revenues we would rather get program cuts, but we're not going to get enough program cuts.
Will the gentleman yield?
I will in a second.
Okay.
And this amendment says that if we don't get the program cuts, reduce the revenues, and then if it turns out that that's inaccurate, we have to reduce revenues even more. Who's asking me to yield?
Will the gentleman yield?
I am.
Ms. Schakowsky.
Thank
first.
You. You know, the committee, the majority committee, provided members with a description of what this bill does for the district, including talking about the surtax. And I would suggest that your side do the same thing. For example, in I've got a whole bunch of them here, it tells the number of small businesses that would receive tax credits. Every one of these that I'm holding is more than is about $12,000 plus small businesses that help. How many seniors would avoid the donut hole in Medicare Part D? That's thousands. How many families would escape bankruptcy? That's in the hundreds. And how many uninsured people in the district that will get coverage? And in all cases, it's over 100,000. And in every single case, 99% plus people in the district will not pay the surcharge. We're talking about a tiny number compared to the hundreds of thousands of people that will help because finally they'll get insurance. You ought to look at this description and so that you can take it a good look at how your district will be helped by this bill. And
I would just say that under this amendment, after you get some analysis, the first priority will be to reduce taxes rather than make sure we keep those promises. And if we can't keep those promises, then we have to look at further reductions in Medicare and Medicaid. This is going to cost us hundreds of billions of dollars and not make the plan work. Now, I suppose that's the goal. Mr. Weiner?
Well, I just want to point out one tax that the minority side refuses to point out. We have a $2.2 trillion in 2007 for health care. That's going to go up, unless we do something, to $3.1 trillion by 2012. I have this high-tech chart here to demonstrate it. Don't forget, if you don't act on legislation to get health care under control, that tax is going to be passed on. I say to my colleague from Louisiana, yes, you can find charges in this bill, but you can't. You have to balance it against the close to $1 trillion of taxes that you seem to
want to do. The time has expired, and we've completed the debate time. We'll now proceed to a vote. And Mr. Barton informs me he'd like a roll call vote. The clerk will call the roll.
Mr. Waxman.
No.
Mr. Waxman votes no. Mr. Dingell. Mr. Dingell votes no. Mr. Markey. Mr. Markey, no. Mr. Boucher. Mr. Pallone. Mr. Pallone, no. Mr. Gordon, Mr. Rush, Ms. Eshoo, Ms. Eshoo votes no. Mr. Stupak, Mr. Stupak, no. Mr. Engel, Mr. Engel, no. Mr. Green, Mr. Green, no. Ms. DeGette. Mrs. Capps, Mrs. Capps, no. Mr. Doyle, Mr. Doyle, no. Ms. Harmon, Ms. Harmon, no. Ms. Schakowsky, Ms. Schakowsky, no. Mr. Gonzalez, Mr. Inslee, Mr. Inslee, no. Ms. Baldwin, no. Mr. Ross, Mr. Ross, no. Mr. Weiner, Mr. Weiner, no. Mr. Matheson, Mr. Butterfield, Mr. Butterfield, no. Mr. Melanson, Mr. Melanson, aye. Mr. Barrow, Mr. Barrow, aye. Mr. Hill, no. Ms. Matsui, Ms. Matsui, no. Mrs. Christensen, no. Ms. Castor, Ms. Castor, no. Mr. Sarbanes? Mr. Sarbanes, no. Mr. Murphy of Connecticut? Mr. Murphy, no. Mr. Space? Mr. Space, no. Mr. McNerney? Mr. McNerney, no. Ms. Sutton? Ms. Sutton, no. Mr. Braley? Mr. Braley, no. Mr. Welch? Mr. Welch, no. Mr. Barton? Mr. Barton votes aye. Mr. Hall? Mr. Hall, aye. Mr. Upton? Mr. Upton, aye. Mr. Stearns? Mr. Stearns votes aye. Mr. Deal? Mr. Deal, aye. Mr. Whitfield? Mr. Whitfield, aye. Mr. Shimkus? Mr. Shimkus, aye. Mr. Shattuck? Mr. Blunt? Mr. Blunt, aye. Mr. Boyer? Mr. Boyer, aye. Mr. Radonovich? Mr. Radonovich, aye. Mr. Pitts? Mr. Pitts, aye. Ms. Bono Mack? Ms. Bono Mack, aye. Mr. Walden? Mr. Walden, aye. Mr. Terry? Aye. Mr. Terry, aye. Mr. Rogers? Aye. Mr. Rogers, aye. Mrs. Myrick? Mrs. Myrick, aye. Mr. Sullivan? Mr. Sullivan, aye. Mr. Murphy of Pennsylvania? Aye. Mr. Murphy, aye. Mr. Burgess? Aye. Mr. Burgess, aye. Ms. Blackburn? Ms. Blackburn votes aye. Mr. Gingrey? Mr. Gingrey, aye. Mr. Scalise? Mr. Scalise, aye. Ms. DeGette? Mr. DeGette votes no. Mr. Gonzalez? Mr. Gonzalez, no. Mr. Matheson? Mr. Matheson, no. Mr. Rush? Mr. Rush votes no. Mr. Shattuck? Mr. Shattuck, aye.
Have all members responded to the call of the roll?
Mr. Gordon?
Any member wish to change his or her vote?
Mr. Gordon? Mr. Gordon votes no.
Clerk will tally the vote and report. Yes.
On that vote, Mr. Chairman, excuse me. On that vote, Mr. Chairman, there were 25 ayes and 33 noes.
25 ayes, 33 noes. The amendment's not agreed to. We're now going to break for an hour, which means we'll come back here at 1:15. We're doing this to accommodate our Republican colleagues and friends so they can attend their conference. So we stand in recess.
The House Energy and Commerce Committee resuming deliberations, first time since July the 21st, been stalled since the majority Blue Dog Democrats working out a deal with the chairman, Henry Waxman. He just mentioned here that they will be recessed here for about an hour. 1:15 is when we expect them back, 1:15 Eastern. They've spent the last 2 hours discussing and voting on amendments to the health care legislation. The chairman had said yesterday that he expects to finish voting on the bill in committee sometime on Friday. On the Senate side of things, a key Republican senator reports the Associated Press involved in the talks on the Senate side and Finance Committee. Mike Enzi said today the bill's not ready for prime time, and he doesn't know any way it can be completed before the break. That's on the Senate side. Also in the Senate, on the nomination of Sonia Sotomayor to be Supreme Court Justice, Lamar Alexander, Republican of Tennessee, went to the Senate floor today to express his support of the nomination, that he will vote in favor of the nomination when it comes to the Senate floor next week. Again, the committee's in an hour recess. They should be back at 1:15 Eastern or so. And while they are in recess, we're going to show you the comments of both Speaker Pelosi, who spoke to reporters just a little while ago. She talked about the